this day. We thank you for your love. We thank you for all the things that we have. We thank you for keeping your hand upon us. Thank you for Pastor Timothy for allowing us to meet in this church. Lord, be with us in this meeting tonight. Open our hearts and our minds in a way that we'll be able to understand more what took place in our history that made America become the greatest country that ever was known in the entire world. So, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we've got a short 90-second video that I'd like to open the class with. And so, anytime you're ready, go ahead and run.
Some time ago, I had a conversation with a Marxist economist from China. He was coming to the end of a Fulbright fellowship here in Boston, and I asked him if he had learned anything that was surprising or unexpected. And without any hesitation, he said, yeah, I had no idea how critical religion is to the functioning of democracy. The reason why democracy works, he said, is not because the government was designed to oversee what everybody does, but rather democracy works because most people, most of the time, voluntarily choose to obey the law. And in your past, most Americans attended a church or a synagogue every week, and they were taught there by people who they respected. My friend went on to say that Americans followed these rules because they had come to believe that they weren't just accountable to society, they were accountable to God. My Chinese friend heightened a vague but nagging concern I've harbored inside that as religion loses its influence over the lives of Americans, what will happen to our democracy? Where are the institutions that are going to teach the next generation of Americans that they too need to voluntarily choose to obey the laws? Because if you take away religion, you can't hire enough police.
But anyway, in our lesson tonight, solemn impact which confirms our God-given rights and individual rights. America was the, there has been no other country greater than America, and even the Constitution and Declaration could not have been written any better by the hearts and minds than our own founding fathers. Because I believe that God raised up a generation at that specific time in history to write the Mayflower, to write the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution and the wording that they used, because these people understood past history. They knew what happened in Rome. They knew Greek history. And so they applied a lot of that to early American history. If you can go to the next one where it says, Know Your Rights. Go a couple of slides over there. One more. There you go. This is a quote from George Washington. If the freedom of speech is taken away, then dumb and silent we may be led, like sheep to the slaughter. And that's exactly what's happening in our country today. And freedom of speech is no longer free. You're scrutinized, and they're called hate crimes. And so a lot of this, we're being suppressed like we've never been suppressed before. And I believe, this is one of my own evaluation of what taking place, as to why America is being attacked so viciously, because we have been one of the greatest nations to spread the gospel to the entire world. There's never been any other nation that can compare the gospel, the outpouring gospel of any other country to the United States. I think if you add in all the countries in the world, they still may become short of spreading the gospel to other countries. This is a quote from John Adams. He said, the moment the idea is admitted into society that property, and this is important because most countries do not have private property. America is probably one of the last countries that own private property. And even the, I think it's the second plank on the Communist Manifesto, is Karl Marx says to eliminate all private property. And that's the reason why the property taxes keep going up. And if people are on fixed incomes, a lot of people are losing their property because they can't make the payments anymore. We basically own very little or nothing anymore in America. We don't own our homes because if you miss a couple of payments on your home, the banks get it. If you miss a couple of payments on your taxes, the state gets it. So you don't even own your own home anymore. And basically the same thing with your automobile. You don't make payments on your automobile, or even if you own your automobile, you have to renew the registration every year. And if you don't renew the registration every year, and you go driving down the street, guess what? The police will pull you over, they'll impound your car, you have impoundment fees and all this other stuff. So we're really rich slaves riding around in chariots, if you want to look at it that way. And it's getting worse and worse and worse. And most of the people have been dumbed down so much that they feel that they can't challenge the courts or they can't challenge the society, and they have to go along with what's happening. That's not true. But I'll just repeat this. The moment the idea is admitted into society, the property is not as sacred as the laws of God, and that there is not a force of the law, public justice, to protect it. One more slide. Anarchy and tyranny commences. If thou shalt not covet and thou shalt not steal were not commandments of heaven, there must be made inviolable to the precepts of every society before it can be citizens or be made free. That was Sir John Adams. The next one is, you knew that statue is up on top there? Okay, that's Moses. That's at the U.S. Supreme Court, and he has the Ten Commandments, one on each side. And this is the statue that Moses and a couple of the Israelites or the Hebrews, that they had engraved and put on the U.S. Supreme Court building. And this is kind of interesting because Jethro, and this is how we got our laws
and our various levels in our courts, because Jethro one day was watching Moses, and he watched it for several days, and he went up to Moses, and he says, "Moses, what in the world are you doing? You're sitting here from morning to sundown with lines of people, and you're trying to solve the problems for them." And he says, I'll just read this word, Exodus 1, 13 to 16, "And it was so, and the next day that Moses sat to judge the people, and the people stood before Moses from morning till evening." I mean, that must have been a job in itself, listening to all these gripes and complaints. And so Jethro, what he did is he told Moses, "What you need to do is you need to have people that you can trust." And we'll go to the next slide. And it says, "Moses' father-in-law saw all that he did for the people and said, 'What is this thing you are doing for the people? Why do you alone sit and to all the people before the morning until evening?' And Moses said to his father-in-law, 'Because the people come to me and inquire of God, and they have difficulties. So actually I'm solving the difficulties for them.'" And we'll go to the next one. "And Jethro replied, 'This thing is too much for you. You are not able to perform yourself.' And then book Exodus 4, 21 to 22. 'Moreover, you shall select from all the people able men, such as fearing God, men of truth, hating covetousness, and place over them the rulers of thousands, rulers of hundreds, rulers of fifties, and rulers of tens, and let them judge the people at all times.'" This is basically how our court system was set up. Moses being the Supreme Court, and all the other courts below. And I've known about this for some years, and so I thought, well, I'll just put this in here as one of the slides for the class that we're teaching. But the smaller matters are in the lower courts, and the ones that are more difficult and more important to a nation as a whole, that goes to the U.S. Supreme Court. And so now you can kind of get an idea as to how our court system was set up. You're ahead of me. This is the first, the Ten Commandments that God gave Moses and the people of Israel was the first moral law given to any nation on earth. God gave Moses the Ten Commandments on Mount Sinai to serve as principles of moral behavior for the human race. The Ten Commandments of God are the foundations of moral code, a legal system of justice for the Western Christian civilization. The architecture of the U.S. Supreme Court building reflects this biblical foundation. At the center of the sculpture over the east portion of the U.S. Supreme Court building, there is an image of Moses holding two tablets of the Ten Commandments. These are engraved over the chair of the U.S. Supreme Court also, and on the bronze door of the U.S. Supreme Court. So at several places in the U.S. Supreme Court building, you will see the same carvings and statues of Moses holding the Ten Commandments. And then we go to the next one about the kingdom of Israel. Israel, this is kind of interesting, because for all these years, Israel was following God and doing what God had asked them to do. And finally, they decided that they no longer wanted to follow what God had for them, but they wanted to do what the other nations, the Gentile nations, were doing. So they were demanding to have a king. And in Deuteronomy 17, 14, "When thou art come unto the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, and shall possess it, and shall dwell therein, and shall say, 'I will set a king over me, and the nations that are about me.'" And in 1 Samuel 1, 8, 7, Saul was the king that they had chosen. Why? They chose him on looks, because he was head and shoulders above all the others, and he was fairly good looking. So they said, "Wow, this is our man." So they were crying to God, and I can just picture them back in the wilderness when they were traveling for 40 years, whining and complaining all that time. Oh, something came to my mind the other day. Why did it take Moses 40 years to wander around in the wilderness? You know?
Because of the complaining?
No, they didn't ask for directions. I just thought of that. So, anyway, but, so here they are again, complaining that they wanted a king. They didn't want to follow God's laws and do what God wanted them to do. So they want to be like the rest of them. Well, I guess that's what God says in the New Testament, that we're not to compromise with the worldly things, right? But yet we see Christians doing it all the time. But anyway, so God knew Saul's heart, but the people didn't know Saul's heart. And all the kings that they had chosen over the years amounted to 42 kings. All of them were evil except for eight. They only had eight good kings out of the 42 kings. Isn't that interesting? I mean, so you can see what the problem Israel had always had. They always had. But see, here we go back to the evilness of man's heart. And anytime you put a person in power over other people, then little Caesar steps in, because now he's got the power over other people. And this is exactly, you can see in our building department, you can see it in other areas in our government, and so on. We go to the next one, the Sadducees. So who were the Sadducees and the Pharisees? They had over 618 laws to control the people. It wasn't for the benefit of the people, it basically was to control the people. The gospel refers often to the Sadducees and Pharisees, as Jesus was in constant conflict with them. The Sadducees and Pharisees comprised of the ruling class of Israel. There were many similarities between the two groups, but important differences between them as well. This is what Jesus said to them and found in Matthew 23:33. Ye serpents, ye generation of vipers, how can ye escape the damnation of hell? Those are pretty strong words.
Yes.
And if you read more and more of what Jesus was confronting the Pharisees, you can almost say that it was almost hostile, because he knew that they were there just to, their heart was not there, and he could see that. In another place in Matthew again, he says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Literally, the word hypocrite refers to an actor, someone playing a part. Sometimes we see this in ministers of churches. They like the limelight. And so it's not their heart. It's not their heart that the reason why they're in the ministry is because they like the limelight. And the Pharisees were basically in the same situation. What is interesting is that the scribes, my understanding, the scribes date as far back as going way back into the days of Egypt. And they were very, very powerful, they were very important, and they were a small group that could read. And they were the ones that led the armies and everything else back in the days of Egypt. And I thought that was pretty interesting. Then we jump forward to the kings of Europe. This is interesting because I had mentioned once before that the kings of Europe, sometimes they'd have a good king, sometimes they'd have a bad king. And most of the time, they'd always have bad kings. The bad kings would go in and they would take their property or they would take whatever they wanted to, just because they were a king. Well, in 1215, the people were getting fed up with what was taking place. And so they had a meeting with King John, and they forced him, they put a sword to his throat, and they told him, you either sign this, basically, or we're going to behead you. And so he signed the Magna Carta. But he didn't enforce it. Matter of fact, he kept doing what he was doing. But it really didn't take effect until some 80-some years later. And finally came into effect. And that's when they called it the Great Charter of Liberty. Because then it became, the people were abiding by laws instead of what the king always had to say. So that was a big turning point in the history of England. The Magna Carta in 1297, Wildie reviews is one of the most important legal documents. The Magna Carta was written by a group of the 13th century barons to protect their rights into the laws of their state and later into the Constitution of the Bill of Rights of the United States. And a lot of our early American history was based on the Magna Carta and basically turned into common law. Common law basically is what? Common sense. And you know, $200 that you would have to do unto you. And so it's the same thing. The U.S. Supreme Court is the supreme law of the land. The Supremacy Clause, this is what we refer to as the Supremacy Clause. Article 6, Section 2 of the U.S. Constitution, known as the Supremacy Clause, because it provides that the Constitution and the laws of the United States shall be the supreme law of the land. It means that the federal government, in the exercising of any of the powers enumerated in the Constitution, must prevail over any conflicting or inconsistent state exercise of power. So they have actually kind of removed themselves from the wording of the Constitution, and states are making laws more and more that is in conflict with the Constitution. And most people don't know about it because the illiteracy rate of the American people are getting down, down. The California Civil Code 35.7, the law helps be vigilant before those who sleep on the rights. In other words, people that are out there really digging and knowing everything, they're the vigilant. But the ones that are just going along to get along, they're sleeping on their rights because they don't know what their rights are. The statutes do not trump the Constitution. And there's a few court cases. The Constitution it oversees or overrides all the ordinances, penal codes, and vehicle codes. Any statute it overrides that is from the state. Now, the next one is, and if you want to write this down, because this is, I'd like for you to research this on your own and Google the Bible and the government, faith and facts. And you're going to get all this information that I have here. And I'm only going to read a couple of the illustrations because this shows you the foundation that America was built on. Even though a lot of people say that America is not a Christian nation, et cetera, we all heard that. But they don't understand how we came about. And there's a couple of areas that I want to point out that are very critical. And the first one is on this first page that we're looking at. And on the first, it talks about the principle. Let me just go over here real quick. Okay, the first one is that there's three areas involved in principle, legal document, and the Bible. The first one is principle, sovereign authority of God, not sovereignty of state or sovereignty of man. And the next one is the legal document. These are legal documents by our country. The Mayflower Compact, the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, currency, oaths, mention of God in all 50 states, constitutions, pledges, and allegiance. The third one is several scriptures that are in the Bible. And I'm only going to read the one that's in Acts 5:29. And these all these scriptures basically pertain to our country. And in Acts 5:29, it says, then Peter said to the other apostles, answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than man. In other words, right now in the news, there is a woman back from one of the states that will not sign the same-sex marriage. And she's because she's abiding by her rights, first by God, and then the state did not pass any laws that she had to sign a document to allowing same-sex marriage. So she's taking a stand. This is the way it should be. God first, and then the states. And the other scripture is in Romans 13:1, let every soul be subject unto a higher power, for there is no power but God. The powers that be are ordained of God. And then the other one that I'm going to be talking about, so you can see where we get all these documents from. And the other one is on the next page. Going over. And go to where it says principles, all men are created equal. There you go. Our next one. Probably one more. One more. One more. Yeah, well, anyway. It says, all men are created equal under principles, a legal document, Declaration of Independence, and then the Bible, the scripture reading. In Galatians 3:28, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male or female, but ye are all one in Christ. In other words, God is no respecter of persons. And that's very important. And that was basically in our Constitution. And the other one is in Timothy, 1 Timothy 2:1-2, or 2 Timothy. I exhort thee, therefore, that the first of all supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving thanks are made for all men, not just a few, not just some, but for all men. And then the last one is for number two is for kings and for all that are in authority, that he may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. And that basically goes with the laws of nature, because that is God's law. You know, do unto others you would have them do unto you, but God says that if you don't harm anybody else, then live in peace. His desire is for everybody to live in peace. But what's happened is because there are some people that want to be in charge of other people, to control other people. And that's the sin or the satanic nature of mankind, because the evilness, they want to control other people. So I'm going to skip a few of these because we need to get to the other side. So over to where it shows the rifle, and there are three involving principles in the, at the very bottom. So keep going, there you go. One more. Okay. To understand what our founding fathers were and how they thought, we almost have to go back to that time of error that they were living in, so that we can have basically the same understanding as how they were, the study habits. If we don't understand the past, and here we go again, if we don't understand the past, then we really don't understand what's happening today and the plan for the future. And so they were very knowledgeable of the Bible, because they didn't have TV back then. They didn't have computers that we have today. They didn't have all these toys that we have now. So guess what? They spent more time in reading. They said that the people back then were more literate percentage than the people are today. Interesting, because they had times to study. So, anyway, I thought that was very important. Let me go over to the next one. Okay. How many of you here know that at one time in our country that you could not even run for state office if you didn't believe in the Trinity? Interesting. You could not even run for public office if you didn't believe in the Trinity. I'm going to give you kind of a little outline right here. All 50 states in our Constitution refers to God. So why is the satanic movement working so hard to eliminate statues of God, the Ten Commandments, and everything else in public places when it's written in our Constitution? What really upsets me is these lawyers that are supposed to be defending our Constitution and our freedoms, where's their mindset? Why don't they bring all this stuff up? I mean, it's like they're working for the other side and they're putting on a big show. I mean, I honestly believe that. I really do. Guess what? They still get paid. They get paid if they lose the case or win the case. So, anyway, God to your own Constitution. This is very interesting, because if you look at the last couple of sentences, our founding fathers did not intend for there to be a separation of God and state, as shown by the facts that all 50 states acknowledge God and state constitution. in California, no more. In California, 1879, the preamble, we the people of the state of California grateful to Almighty God for our freedom. Alaska, 1956, preamble, we the people of Alaska grateful to God and to those who founded our nation and pioneered this great land. Arizona, 1911, preamble, we the people of the state of Arizona grateful to Almighty God and our liberties to do ordain this constitution. I mean, if it says it all, folks, I'm sorry, but it says it all. We go to the next one. Belief in God requires holding office. Besides Maryland, the other six states with language in the Constitution that prohibits people who do not believe in God from holding public office. And they are Alaska, Mississippi, North Carolina, South Carolina, Tennessee, and Texas. What happened over the years, since then, see, these states became states and drew up constitutions before the original Bill of Rights came into existence and the state constitution, or the U.S. Constitution. So they already had this in their state constitution. So that, so this constitutional requirement that any office holder must be believe in God before they can even run for public office. This isn't about discrimination or bigotry. It's all about ensuring that those holding public office are aware in the best interest of our country. You know, atheists, you're discriminating against atheists. That's always what they use, but it wasn't, because even cults, religious cults, there's some that don't believe in the Trinity. So that just erases that. Godly leaders for a godly nation. In the Articles of Confederation of the United Colonies in New England, May 19th, 1643, so this is way before the Constitution was drawn up, but it begins with the following Articles of the Confederation between the plantations under the government of Massachusetts, the plantations under the government of New Plymouth, and the plantations under the government of Connecticut, and the government of New Haven, and the plantations of a combination therein. Whereas we all come into these parts of America with one and the same end and aims, namely to advance the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ and to enjoy the liberties of the gospel in purity and peace. And whereas, in our settling by the wise providence of God, we are further dispersed upon the sea coast and rivers than was the first intent, so that we can now, in according to our desires, with the covenants and communicate in one government and one justice. So that was the language in their constitutions at that time. The next one is the Delaware. This is what they had to actually sign when they ran for office. And Delaware Constitution in 1776 established by a godly state by requiring in Article 22, every person who shall be chosen a member of either house or appointed to any office or place of trust shall make a subscription of the following declaration of wit. I, person's name, do profess faith in God the Father and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, and in the Holy Ghost, one God, blessed forevermore, and I do acknowledge the Holy Scriptures to be of the Old and New Testament to be given by divine inspiration. That's what they had to sign before they could even run for public office. See, those people wanted to protect the integrity of God, and they knew that if more people got elected, guess what would happen? The moral decay of our nation would have gone down much faster. So basically, there was U.S. Supreme Court rulings and things like that based on this. And so it was referred to as the religious test. You couldn't have a religious test for running for office. So, it's kind of interesting. One more. The three branches of government of the United States is called the legislative, executive, and judicial. But in the Fifth Amendment, it also talks about one other, and a couple of the U.S. Supreme Court justices said that the grand jury is actually the fourth branch of government. And what they have done is that because of the importance of the grand jury, they kind of moved that aside because it's so critical in investigating these various crimes. And so, like in Ferguson and some of the others, you hear people say, we want to change the grand jury, we want to change the grand jury. Well, these basically are communists that are wanting to change the grand jury, because what happens when a person, when they're interviewing people, all the comments, they can speak freely in the grand jury, because it will not, it stays there. So a person knows that he's not intimidating. What's happened, I think this started in 1947, is when they changed some of the federal laws, that before then, and I could be wrong, but before then, there was no prosecuting attorney nor district attorney on the grand jury. Now they place the district attorney and the prosecuting attorney on the grand jury, so what? They can influence the juries on various decisions, which is wrong, because the jury is supposed to be independent from the government. You see how Satan works his little, tentacles in, and it starts destroying it, a little here, a little there, and pretty soon it's totally corrupt. So, basically, the Constitution of the United States declares that the people of the United States created the governments to establish justice, ensure democratic tranquility, promoting the general welfare and secure the blessings of liberty. In the 14th Amendment, the United States Constitution, which declares that no state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges and immunities of citizens of the United States. So you can see how over the years our form of government has been deteriorating. And not enough good people are taking a stand or trying to understand what they can stand up against. Let's go to the next one, California. Civil law. There you go. The California Civil Law Code 22.2, the common law of England, so far as it is not repugnant to or inconsistent with the Constitution of the United States or the Constitution or laws of the state, this is ruled of the decision in all of the courts of the state. In other words, when a state, and I mentioned this a little bit earlier, when a state draws up their laws and their statutes, they should always look at the Constitution, U.S. Constitution first, and if there's any conflict, then they can't make that a law. But they do it anyway. The Bill of Rights, the First Amendment, Congress shall make no law, we touched on that earlier, but Congress shall make no law respecting to the establishment of the religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. But see, that changed. For 100 or so years, that was never challenged until after the Communist Party got involved and communism started getting involved in America. Then was the first challenge to our constitutional rights as far as religion, and I think it was like in the late 1800s when it was first challenged. So you can see the communist movement very much involved in America. We go to the next one. Under California Evidence Code 520, the party claiming that a person is guilty of a crime or wrongdoing, they have the burden of proof. So if you're out passing out literature or doing something, and a person comes up to you and tells you you can't do that, say, fine, show me the law and I will quit. A lot of times people will come up to you just because they don't like what you're doing and tell you you can't do that. And so you just say, fine, I appreciate the law, I respect the law, show me the law and I will quit doing it. And the burden of proof then falls on them. And if they can't show it, just keep doing what you're doing. The United States Code 42, next one, in 1983 is the most widely used code section of civil action for deprivation of rights. In other words, what they're saying here is that you can sue somebody on civil rights using this code, and they can't, if they're working in the government, that money does not come out of the treasury, it comes out of their own pocket. Interesting. So you let them know beforehand that you're going to sue them, and then if they continue or nothing happens, nothing changes, then you can file papers, and there's ways of doing that. So it's interesting. The California Constitution, Article 1, Declaration of Rights. All people are by nature free and independent of having inalienable rights. Among these are enjoying and defending the life and liberty, acquiring possession, and this is property, and protecting property, and in pursuing and obtaining safety and happiness and privacy. This is one of our God-given rights, but these are all being taken away from us. And we can see that happening all the time. Go down to numbers, that's the 16, the one more. There we go. Trial by jury. Years ago, that anytime somebody broke the law or did something, they would have a grand jury, and the grand jury would be investigating the situation, but it got too slow. And our rights for the Constitution, we have a grand jury that we can go to. And a grand jury basically is the one to set the amount of damage. In other words, what I'm thinking of, if you do property damage and there's a jury, the jury determines the amount that the owner lost because you did damage to the property. But if you're driving down the street, not wearing a seatbelt, and a police officer pulls you over, and it's an automatic fine, who set that fine for what amount? It has to be determined by the jury of what that crime, the damage of that crime. And if there's no person that is complaining, because it has to be a person that's complaining of the damage, if there's no person complaining of the damage, then you don't, there's no law broken. But they set these statutes up and these ordinances up and these penal codes up because it's money, it's revenue for the city and the state. And they're looking for all ways to do this. The next one with the jury. There we go. In several cases, the jury shall consist of 12 people, or lesser number, if it's agreed on by both parties, so that they can have 8. In the case of other than cases within the appellate judicial court, the appeals and legislation may provide that the jury shall consist of 8 persons, and if they both agree. In a criminal action in which a felony is charged, the jury shall consist of 12 persons. And in criminal actions in which a misdemeanor is charged, the jury shall consist of 12 persons, or a lesser number agreed by the parties in open court. In all traffic violations, is an infraction. It's not a misdemeanor. It only becomes a misdemeanor if you're threatened by an officer or somebody else of the government. Then that becomes a misdemeanor. Go to the next one, the 5th, there you go. The 5th Amendment, this is very important. This is what I was talking about earlier about the grand jury. The 5th Amendment creates a number of rights relative to both criminal and civil legal proceedings. In criminal cases, the 5th Amendment guarantees the right to a grand jury, forbids double jeopardy. And I'm thinking of that when you go to a traffic court, it is double jeopardy, because if you go and the judge says not guilty, but then he reassigns you to another date, and you have to go to court again, and that's when the officer is there, that to me is double jeopardy right there, because he'd already said not guilty. And he should dismiss the case. But they don't do that. And so this is one more step that we're trying to work out and see what the legal grounds that we can have when the judge determines, because that happened to me, and it's happened to several other people, then you just refer to another date, and that's when they bring in the officer. Well, they should bring in the officer at that point, but they don't do that. So, anyway.
Who
You can request a jury, trial by jury, but it's never granted.
Yeah, but who appoints the jury?
The state does.
On the state?
Yeah. Yeah.
And you're talking about forming them on yourself. How would you get that in an operation yourself where you could be appointed?
Well, we are doing a lot of research. We have been for the last year and a half about starting a grand jury. A grand jury is independent from a government. You do not need any official government official in the grand jury. A grand jury is a group of people coming together because they see some injustice, and so.
What gives them authority to form an opinion so that they can judge you on that without you having to follow?
Because any kind of grand jury suspects the any part of government doing something that is not kosher, not correct or illegal, they can investigate to see if the findings are true.
That's true, but how do they take the opinion of an outside grand jury and make it legal in court so
they can... Well, because you have to go back a few years. There are only a few states that are set up for grand juries. Not every state adheres to the grand jury, even though it's in the Fifth Amendment. So we'll discuss that a little bit later on, but we are looking into it. And you can form your own grand jury. And there is a movement in the last 10 years to have more grand juries throughout the United States. And they're even doing that in England now because everything is becoming so corrupt. So let's skip on to the next person. One more. There you go. This is the grand jury actually can be traced way back into 940 AD, and it was started in Athens, Greece. And from there, it went to Rome, and then from Rome, it went to Europe, and then in the 1600s, it actually went to I think it was Massachusetts was the first one to have a grand jury.
Do they form a grand jury like they do from a jury school, like you
do? No, the grand jury, see, this is something new to everybody.
Yeah.
And so what you do, you can put an ad in the paper that you're forming a grand jury, and that way you're not biased. And so people that want to be informed, then they take an oath to uphold the Constitution and to protect the citizens. What's happening in all governments, you can go back to day one, that all governments, when they come into authority, they become corrupt. And corruption breeds corruption. But when you have citizens in the community that are safeguarding that community, then everybody is looking out for that community. That's the way it's supposed to be set up. So you can even appoint your own sheriff. You can appoint your bailiff. You can even everything. And you can make a citizen's arrest. And we'll go into all that a little bit later on. But the people can form their own grand juries. They have that right. And while we're on the subject, let's see. Oh, go to the next one. One more. Go closer to the bottom. One more. There we go. In America, the Massachusetts Bay Colony impaneled the first grand jury in 1635. To consider a case for murder, robbery, and wife beating. As early as the 1700s, the value of the grand jury was recognized, and opposing the royalists, that means opposing the King of England. In other words, they were trying, the King of England sent all their corrupt lawyers and judges to the United States because of the Boston Tea Party. And they were trying to try and convict the colonists for throwing all the Boston, the tea over the side of the ships and rebelling against Britain. But here goes the jury too, because the juries weren't moving fast enough and convicting people fast enough. So in my understanding at this time, the King formed what they call the Maritime, or the Maritime Court. In other words, they had one judge, he was the ruler of that court. And so he could convict anybody. He didn't have to follow laws. It was just whatever he said. So they could move people in and out. That sounds just like our traffic courts, you know, several hundred a day. And so, but getting back to the lesson here, so Massachusetts and our early founders, they were opposing the King of England and the royalists over there, and these colonial grand juries expressed their independence by refusing to indict leaders of the Stamp Act in 1765 and refusing to bring libel charges against the editor of the Boston Gazette in 1765. A union with other colonies to oppose British taxes was supported by a Philadelphia grand jury in 1770. By the end of the colonial period, the grand jury had become an indispensable agent to the government. They proposed new laws. They protested against abuse in government, and they wielded a tremendous authority in their power to determine who should and who should not face trial. They also were involved in building bridges and make sure the bridges were done right, in road constructions and everything else. They were very much involved, but somewhere along the line, they started falling by the wayside. And then the government started expanding. The government started doing what they were doing, but ended up being more corrupt. So that's, we gotta get back to the grand juries. I just want to do this one more. It's on the American flag. There we go. We're going to start with this one, but when you get a chance, Google the Admiralty Court exists because the U.S. is under martial law. Basically, it still is under martial law because Abraham Lincoln imposed martial law during that time, and he never took it off the calendar. And every several years, they have to enact in a war, whether it's war against crime, whether it's war against drug, whether we're involved in a physical war with another country. We always have to be in a wartime scenario. The Admiralty Court exists because of the U.S. is under martial law. If you go on, you go back one. There you go. On the upper right-hand corner, the yellow fringe is not authorized on the Title 4 of the U.S. Code, Chapter 1, Section 1 and 2. The flag is a mutilation, Section 3. If you go down about halfway, the gold tassel is admiralty. If you go at the very bottom, this flag with the yellow fringe represents no nation and no constitution. So in other words, the judge of that courtroom, and that's why when you go into court, you see the admiralty flag in so many of the courts. I've only been in one court that had the regular American flag, but the courtrooms certainly that have the admiralty flag is like the captain of the ship. He is the captain. He is the judge. Whatever he says goes. So in court, when you see an admiralty flag, that judge, whatever he says, is law. It's just that simple. They don't have to adhere to the Constitution, even though they took taken the Constitution oath of the Constitution to hold the Constitution protected citizens. They don't have that. They don't use it. So, question.
I thought an admiral was a general of the fleet.
You're associating a person. You associate a person with this different. Yeah, do some research on this. It's pretty interesting. So,
well, anyway, any other questions?
Can you request a neutral flag in the
courtroom? You can. Let's go ahead and put this in. Anyway.
I believe the reason churches use the gold on it is to signify that they recognize God as a higher authority than the United States Constitution.
That's true. I don't know. Yeah. You know, I've asked a couple of pastors, you know, why do you have an admiralty flag?
I believe that is the reason. I didn't know, so I went and looked it up when you talked to me about it.
Okay.
And that's what I found in some places was that it was to signify that they respected the fact, the laws of the United States, however, that they recognized God as a supreme ruler over even country.
That's a good reason.
Yeah, that's a good reason.
I never heard that. I never heard that. Anyway, any other questions? Well, thank you.
coming. I appreciate it.